Hey, this is Jared with eCarrier Check, and I got Tavaris here. He is literally the king of straight trucks. Tavaris honestly has an incredible YouTube page with all of his straight truck information, and I'm excited you're on. Tavaris, thank you for being here today.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, yeah. Tavaris, give us a rundown. Like, you know, tell us, how long have you been in the freight industry? What do you do? You know, how have you found some success? Give us just kind of an understanding of who you are.
Well, as far as the transportation industry, I've been doing that for at least about maybe about 7 years. But you know, I've been doing it for other companies in management. So it was a management role. So I kind of had some familiarity with the industry. And then I just got to a point where I feel like I wanted to try it out myself as an independent courier, a carrier. And so I just went out there and did it. Actually, I just went out and got me a vehicle. And then I kind of like, you know, which I would recommend, you know, doing your research first, but you know, I went out and just did it and learned on the way. And so some of my successes came from just my failures, actually.
Yeah, go into that a little bit. I love what you're talking about there. You mentioned, you know, your successes turned out from things that you learned from failing. Talk about those moments, or even walk us through what happened and then how it turned out to be a success.
Okay, so when I first started, you know, I tried to watch some videos on YouTube, but I wasn't really into watching videos that much. So, you know, I saw one video and then I just went out and said, oh, this seemed like a business that I can get into that's not too expensive. And it seemed pretty easy, laid back, stress-free, you know? So I went out and I got a van. So not knowing what type of van to get, I just got anything, you know? And that's why it's important to do your research, know what type of niche that you want to do, you're going to have, you know, in that particular industry. And so I went, I got a cargo van, a Dodge Promaster City. It's a small van, 87 inches in length. But I was thinking of doing what I had in my mind, I would be doing over the road expedited. And if you know most people that do over the road, you're going to have a Sprinter van, a box truck, something like that, something that can hold at least, you know, 2 to 3 pallets. But my van can only hold one. And so that was mistake number one, you know, not doing enough research, not knowing exactly what I wanted to get into. So that was mistake number one. But then I was like, okay, I got this van, I got to make it work. And then that's when I started researching a lot of apps and things like that, that, you know, and then finding freight that could fit my van. So if that was doing local work, that's what I would do. And so I kind of like piece it all together, and that would be a way for me to, you know, to make money I feel like I needed to make. And so that was one of the first errors I made. And then I was like, you know, let me figure out how I can fix this. And that's, you know, one of the steps I did in the beginning.
How long did it take you to correct this mistake, to get the proper equipment? What was that length of time period when you said, I just need to get a different truck?
Well, I still have that vehicle.
Oh, you do? Okay. All
right. Yeah. I said, no, I'm going to make this work. Because one thing that I try to tell people, and especially in cargo vans, so there's a lot of groups on social media with cargo vans, and one of the questions that I always see is, you know, can I make money with this cargo van? And so I was like, no, it don't matter what type of vehicle you got, you can make money in it. Now, you might not be able to make the $10,000 a week or whatever, you know, but you can make money. You can make money and be comfortable. So I wanted to prove to myself that, hey, you can make money in this vehicle. Okay. You got to think outside the box. And so I didn't buy another vehicle. My plan is to, you know, use the one I have and then scale up and buy an ad vehicle. But no, I wanted to make that work because, you know, it's almost kind of like, this is what happens when you don't plan. No, now you got to deal with this. So I wanted to deal with it, and that's what I did. So I still have that vehicle, and
okay,
I can get loads. I can find work, and when I talk to people, I let them know, hey, yes, you got a small van, but there's things you can do to make money with your van.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's transition in finding loads for what you're doing. Obviously, you're picking up the phone or you're stopping by local places. What seems to be the most effective for you? You know, is it technology? Is it human interaction? What seems to work for you, or is it a combination?
It's a combination. So I like to use a lot of on-demand apps. So that's one thing I use. But you don't want to depend on that as your means for making money for your business, because that's just something that, you know, they put a load out, order out, but you got other people that are around that can accept that order. So that's just one source of income for your business. The best way to do it would be direct, you know, going to businesses, telling them who you are, what type of vehicle you have, or what type of service you provide. That's the best way, because you get that work directly with them. You don't have to worry about too much competition, you know, with load boards, things like that. And load boards is another thing that a lot of people use. I use them too, but that's not the way to try to run your business just off a load board, because it's inconsistent and you really have no control.
Right? None at all. I would say that load boards would hopefully be kind of last case scenario. You're getting direct shippers is definitely the way to go. Now, were you strategic in the fact that you went after a certain industry? Did you just start going after, you know, anybody and everybody? What did the sales presentation look like?
Well, that's another thing that I actually mentioned that today in a consultation, as far as, you know, when I was going around trying to get business from people, I was going to anybody. But then you got to think about your equipment. You know, the company that you're going to, is their freight, is that what you want to carry? You know, it could be long, awkward freight. It could be real fragile. Is that something that you want to deal with? So you shouldn't really just go pick up anything. You know, you got to decide what areas, you know, you want to work in. And so, you know, when I go to these companies, it's very simple. Before I did it, I was like, okay, man, I don't really want to go to these people. They're going to tell me no. They're not going to need me. But after, you know, the past few months, I started to realize that these people need you more than you think. They are not out here saying, hey, we need you. You have to go to them, you know. And because a lot of people are afraid of that no and things like that, these companies start using apps. They'll start using other things to try to get these the freight moved, you know, because people don't want to go knock on their doors. But when I go to the customers, potential customer, I would just say, hey, my name is Tavaris. I just started a courier business. I just want to know if you need any help transporting your freight or any type of service I can provide, how can I help you? And that's pretty much it. They would say, yes, we need you. No, we already got somebody. They may ask you for your card. They'll say, no, do you have this type of insurance? Or, you know, it's very simple. But a lot of people tend to overthink it, and you know, it's not, you shouldn't put them that much thought into it.
Yeah. You mentioned, you know, you had the mentality that they were going to tell you no, or they already had somebody. How did you get over that hurdle in your head? How is mental toughness built into Tavaris's head? What do you do to get over that?
Well, one thing about when you start a business and you start to see failure, it's like you get hungry. It's like, oh, I got to do something or else. And so what made the moment, it's crazy, because I was on the phone with someone and I was like, you know, I just went to a few companies and said, oh, you know what it is? You hungry. You know, you sitting around, like, we talk about load boards. I see a lot of people that say, hey, man, I haven't had a load in 2 weeks, because you depend on the load board. And so that's what I was doing. I was like, you know, I put bids in. I'm not getting the response. That's because somebody else is going lower than I'm going. And so I'm like, you know what? I need to go to these businesses and talk to them myself. And that's what it was. It was like, you got to do something, or you can go back to, you know, doing whatever. So that's what it really was all about. Just tired of just seeing no, or not being able to move your vehicle. You still got to pay your monthly note. You know, you still got to pay your bills. Yeah. But you can't sit here and be like, I hope somebody got to accept the load for me. No, you got to go out there and see if you can get that direct business yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's interesting is when I started eCarrier Check, my dad came over the night we launched, and it was kind of interesting. He gave me a boat, and I still have this at my house right now. And it's a boat that it looks like he took like a torch to it, and it was just burnt. And it's on this little stand, and it's all charred up. And he goes, don't look back, burn those boats. And it was just kind of interesting to kind of put it in perspective. If you don't go all in, burn the boats, make them into cabins, and let's go. We got no choice. You got to make it work. So I love that. I love that mentality. You know, you mentioned apps. You know, how do you use apps? Or is it for tracking purposes? Are you finding clients on there? What, give us a rundown on the apps, Joel.
These apps are kind of like, these are on-demand apps also. So, you know, these apps have customers that need, you know, freight moved. So one of the apps, you know, I mentioned is Freight Francis. You know, they should be paying me actually, because I'll be mentioning them a lot. But, you know, Freight is the one that I like because, you know, so they got customers like Sherwin-Williams, the towel shop. And so Sherwin-Williams may need paint moved from Spartanburg to Charlotte. And so with the app, you download the app, it'll send out an order, you know, tell you where it's going, how much it's paying. And then, you know, just go, you know, you say, I can accept it, and you go pick it up and make delivery. So that's how these apps work. But one of the things I try to tell people is that you don't, when you do, I just don't accept a load and then go to these customers, pick it up and deliver, and that's it. When I go there, I'm talking to the people, how can I become a direct vendor? And some of that has worked. So that's how I use it. Everybody else, they may just use this. I made some money, that's it. No, I want to figure out how can you use me instead of using the app.
Yeah, absolutely. As far as operationally speaking, have you had challenges? How's billing? How's payments? How is operationally running your van?
Well, I haven't had any issues yet. A lot of you know, especially with some of the companies I work with, you know they pay me, so you know I get it's not a pay stub, but you know they send me, but it is a pay stub. So it's not like I'm doing the financial part myself. Like I'm not what's the word I can use? I'm basically I'm using their systems.
Yeah.
So the apps, they send you the paycheck, they send you the tax information at the end of the year. The same thing with these companies I work with. They send me all the tax information, the insurance things, all that stuff. They send it to me at the end of the year. Now I do have to take my own taxes out. So, I would do that at the end of the year.
That's
but
fair.
You can do that in multiple. You can do it as far as taxes go, you can do that any way you want, but you know, I choose to, you know, wait.
Yeah. How about maintenance side of things? Obviously, you're driving a vehicle around. Has there been a lot of maintenance that's come up that's been a surprise, or has it been what you thought it would be?
I haven't had any issues. For the most part, I haven't had to get my vehicle. Nothing has broken on my vehicle yet. Just oil changes and just regular checkups, but nothing has, you know, fell apart or nothing like that. And that's probably because I don't get on the road. I don't do much over the road. You know, I try to do local work, whether it's within the city or within, you know, a few hours. But you know, I'm pretty sure if I was driving thousands and thousands of miles a week, then it would be different. So I try to and that's one of the things that I try to do, try to minimize my calls. Since I got a smaller vehicle, I try to work locally because I know that it'll be hard for me to get a lot of loads. So, you know, I haven't had any maintenance issues.
Nice. As far as, you know, looking forward, obviously you've got a pretty decent process down of finding loads and getting direct shippers. Has there been an industry that you want to get into with your van that's kind of this golden nugget, or is there, what's, you know, by the end of this year, what's the goals? What are you trying to get accomplished?
I like the medical industry, because a lot of the freight, it's not even really freight. A lot of the things I pick up, like specimen, it's very simple stuff. It's like actually doing medical work. I have only needed to use my van once. Now I do have an order next week where I'm going to use my van, but through the medical company, but I haven't had to use my van but one time. And so if I was able to get a lot of contracts with medical companies, I would do that because it's simple. And so that's my plan, is to get more into the medical industry, which I'm writing a book now about the medical courier business. So hopefully I can get that done within the next month or so. But so the medical industry is one I like.
I love that. You're going to have to send me this book when you get it done. I'm a big fan of that. Okay. I love that you're doing that. How, if you were going to give some advice to somebody that's getting started, there's a lot of, you know, straight truck guys out there, sprinter van guys out there. There's a lot of these guys, you know, when you look at all the DOT numbers coming into the workforce, a lot of them are these smaller trucks. You know, what advice would you give those guys as far as, you know, maybe not only in sales, but marketing and just getting started?
One of the things that I would probably, you know, as far as advice I would give them is, again, know what service you're going to provide. You know, are you going to be over the road? Are you going to be doing, you know, medical, local routes? Because that kind of determines what type of vehicle you should get. You know, some people come out and they get sprinter vans, but they want to work locally doing, you know, medical work. And so you don't need a sprinter van. So now you just wasted all this money on a sprinter van and you don't need it. Or you'll have it the other way around. People have a small van, but they want to drive over the road. I mean, I had people today mention that they got a smaller van and they want to know if they can move freight. You can move freight, but the amount of freight you can pick up is going to be limited. And, you know, a lot of people want to probably turn you down because of the type of vehicle you have. So knowing what service you want to provide, that will determine, you know, what type of insurance you need, because some people think that you need the $1 million policy, cargo insurance, for everything, and you don't. You know, so knowing what you want to get into first. And then one of the most important things is also knowing your expenses. So when you know your expenses, you can kind of know what kind of rate that you want to set when you go to these customers. Because when I've been to a customer and try to get direct business, and they asked me what my rate was. I had no idea. Now you look like you don't know what's going on out here. Mm-hmm. You know, so when you know your expenses, you can kind of have an idea of what I'm going to say when I go to the customer. Okay, so if your rate is $2 per mile, okay, that's what you tell them. But only when you know your expenses. So for me, I like to have a bottom dollar. So I cannot go below this. What I want, and you know, anything above that is a plus. But I do know that I can't accept anything less than my bottom dollar.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people don't know exactly what to charge. Because people ask me all the time, you know, what do you charge? And the other thing is, don't worry about what the next person is making. You know,
okay.
You got to focus on what your business can do and how you're going to take care of yourself, your family, your bills. So you can't focus on if person B is charging someone, you know, I'm just going to make a number, $1,000 a week for a service, and you charge, let's say, $700 a week. You know, you don't know what relationship they have with that customer. You don't know how long they've been doing this. So you gotta focus on your number. If your number is 700, after you run your numbers and the number is 700, that's what you go with. Don't worry about over, because see, people think that you can underbid and overbid yourself. Now, I would rather go in and underbid, because if you go too high, they're not gonna listen to you at all.
Right.
You go too low, you can get the business, and then later on, you can gradually move on up. So definitely focus on yourself. Don't worry about the next person, what they're making. Just run your operation, because it's yours. And like I said, you don't know what the other person's situation is.
Yeah. How do you? You brought up something kind of interesting. How do you know what your expenses are?
I'm talking about, like, you know, let's say if that's what you do full time, that's your full time income. So you know what your rent or mortgage is, you know all of those expenses. Okay. And you got your vehicle expenses, your maintenance, your insurance, all that stuff. And then once you add all that up, and then you break it down into, you know, what you need per mile, that's the rate you'll come up with. And some people may have high expenses where they need, hey, I need $5 a mile. Well, you know, you may need to go drive a semi or something. You may need to go get your CDL. I don't know. But you definitely want to know what it is, and then and figure out how to put those pieces together, whether you got to get one contract, two contract, three contract, to get that dollar amount that you need.
Yeah. How about, you know, you mentioned pricing. How about minimums? You know, minimums are kind of this interesting world. Obviously, if you're going 2 miles and you're charging, you know, $5 a mile, that obviously isn't working. So where do minimums come into play when you're thinking about what you're worth hourly wise?
All right, so okay, you said minimum. You mean it like if yeah. it's
What's your lowest charge, right? You mentioned your lowest charge. You know, if a guy asks you to go 2 miles down the street, you know, how do you come up with what your minimum comes to be? Is it an hourly thing? Is it, you know, is it, I'm going to take, you know, $65 an hour and it's only going to take me 30 minutes. So this is going to charge you $35. Yeah. How do you kind of hit that?
Yeah, you can do it that way. I mean, you can say I'm charging 75 cents a minute. You can go by the minute. You can go by a flat rate. Okay, if it's anything under 50 miles, this is $200. Anything under 50 miles, it's $100. But once you get past 50 miles, now I'm charging you $2 a mile and things like that. Because like you said, you can say, if you was to go to the one and say, I'm charging $2 a mile, and they say, well, this is going 10 miles on the road. You're talking about $20, you know? So anything under a certain radius, you can say, I'm charging a flat fee of whatever it is, $200. Because I've had loads where it was one in Greenville, to Greenville. So it was like 6 miles up the same road. I got $200 for that load.
Okay.
And so and people should understand, don't think that these companies don't have the money. They have the money, but you know, it's really about who at this point, it's really about who's the cheapest, especially when you're talking about load boards. Now, when you're talking about working directly with a customer and they got work for you every day, things like that, that's where you can come to negotiate how much you're gonna charge. But definitely have the money for it. It's all about, you know, you building that relationship. So it's so many different ways that you can break down how much you want to charge and what your minimum is. It's just you got to find out what's the best rate for you.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great information. That's awesome. Tavaris, obviously you love helping people and doing some coaching on the side. How do people get a hold of you, or what's the best way for them to contact you, Tavaris?
Well, I mean, so I got my YouTube channel, which is my name. It's Tavaris Little, you know, TavarisLittle. And then on Instagram, TL Enterprise 15. Okay. This is how you know I don't really be on Instagram that much, but it's at TL Enterprise 15, okay. and then my other one is at TLittle32 on Instagram. So that's how a lot of people have been reaching out to me, sending me messages, filling out my link for my consultation and subscribing to my YouTube channel. So that's where they can find me.
That's awesome, man. Well, you add a lot of content. I love your channel. You just have you're cutting your teeth and sharing your story all at the same time. And I honestly love it. It's raw. It's just great data. It's good information to watch. So, Tavaris, thank you for being on. Thank you for the insights. And I wish you well. I really do.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.
All right.